Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Astute Advantage Listen Up podcast. And today I've got the pleasure of having Stuart Faulkner back again from Morgan Thompson HR. How are you, Stuart?
Brilliant, mate. Thanks. I had a really nice weekend. What about you?
Long weekend? Lovely Easter weekend. You know what? I feel like we're both like in different acclimatized conditions. There's me with my old jumper. with your open shirt and your like sunny background. What's going on? Yeah. Where are we?
I was wearing a suit, yeah. So I don't know why I chose that background. I'd be an idiot to be on the beach in my suit, right?
So, Stuart, you know what? We had you on before. Anybody that hasn't watched this before, I've worked with Stuart over the years on a number of different challenging HR employment law matters. Fantastic guy, super clever, and we always I love the conversation we talk about. A lot of it's to do with mindset, as well as just not HR practical stuff. And today's topic, Stuart, was it kind of was a bit tongue-in-cheek in my mind in terms of it can be funny, but I imagine sometimes it's not. And it's how to handle embarrassing conversations in the workplace. Handling tricky conversations is a real skill, in fact. And if people can master that, well, they won't need us probably in a lot of the workplace situations, but handling them is kind of key. And before we get into that, Stuart, tell us, anybody that hasn't seen you before on our podcast, tell us a little bit about yourself on why anybody watching this podcast should be listening to you about today's topic.
Why should they be listening to me? Well, I mean, I've worked in HR for over 20 years, worked for myself for 10, 12 years. So I work with small businesses and advise them how to have conversations with staff. It's interesting, isn't it? Because we both inhabit the world of employment law.
Yeah.
But the longer I do my job, the longer I engage with my clients, the longer I have to deal with queries that they have with me. It becomes more about the engagement. Is how do you address these issues? How do you bring it to the people's attention so you get the right result? And that then makes me more, I would say more of a coach, but I feel like I coach my clients more about the way they'd have those conversations, because any HR person can terminate someone's contract, right? We all know how to manage a disciplinary, but it's about the way that you have those conversations and understanding the difference between the soft skills and the hard skills, which I realize over the years I've become more adept at.
Oh, you're so right. You know what? We're not call us an HR person, employment lawyer, whatever the label is. If you're not a problem solver, you're nothing to them. There's no value to add. So it's really about, have you got the skill set to solve those problems that your clients have? And this is one small aspect that we're going to be covering today. So I think you had a specific embarrassing situation or conversation that you had that you wanted to talk about.
Well, do you know what? I've had over the years, actually, it's not actually as uncommon as you might think, but I've had a few situations where a staff member has smelt, has had unpleasant body odor. And, you know, I can only imagine from my own experiences, like if someone was to say, you know, I can smell you smell, and that's an unpleasant smell. That's not an easy thing to hear, right? That's a really difficult.
Sure. What do? You get a bar of soap and you kind of push it across the table, or?
But you know what? I remember a case years and years ago, where it was actually a case of bullying, and the manager had actually said to the employee, go to the bathroom and scrub off your perfume. Scrub off your perfume because I don't like it.
Wow.
And because that person had been in position for quite a long time and had the authority that went with it. So when I say the authority, it had been there for like 20 years.
Yeah.
And so it's my way or the highway sort of thing.
Yes.
And that employee had felt, and the team that worked around her had felt like this woman's demeanor was belittling. You know, it was degrading in a way. You know, I don't like the way you smell, therefore I want you to go to the bathroom and wash it off. I want you to scrub it off. And I think that was an example. But
that's
but
slightly even, different situation, Stuart, than what we were discussing.
It is.
Of somebody smelling with because their body odor. Rather than, you know, I don't like your perfume, and that's a bit more.
Then recently I've had two clients that have contacted me with members of staff that have had excessive odor and asking me about how to have the conversation. And it's quite a straightforward advice to give, right? Just tell someone, take them to one side, I'm really sorry, but I've got to tell you this, but it's not easy for me to say it. It's not going to be easy for you to hear it, but, you know, I've noticed the fact that there's an unpleasant odor and I need you to take care of it.
Gosh.
And at least you start having the dialogue. But I guess what's become interesting, Tosh, though, with a couple of the cases is the background noise, is the context. For example, some of the team had made comments. So they're making comments to the manager, right, saying this has become unbearable. I remember as well that I've received phone calls from more than one person. So the line manager, then that person's manager, because the problem was being kicked down the road a little bit, you know, is that I don't really want to have this conversation. You know, it's unpleasant, you know, it's an unpleasant one. But then helping them understand that the authority is with you. You are entitled to have that conversation. And by being honest with them and being open about what you're trying to achieve from it, then, you know, you can find a result that's agreeable for everyone. And in one of those cases, there was an element of there being like a hormone issue, that there had been something that had been diagnosed by the GP.
Yeah.
Now it's a different type of conversation, right? Now you're having a very different conversation because you want to know, well, what did the GP say? You know, how have they managed it, and what was the advice they gave you? And there was some options on the table, but then made it easier for the manager to start engaging in the dialogue, because it's like, well, you are taking steps to manage the situation. And well, while you're going through that process of getting advice from your GP about what you're going to, what the steps are, how can we together manage this with the team? You know, so that people are aware that you're aware of it and you're doing something about it. Because if you don't do that, you've got people talking about you behind your back.
Yeah,
that's just gossiping. Yeah, now you've got a situation that's going to affect the well-being of the office. Now, what's also interesting, Tosh, if you don't mind me going on, was when that conversation evolved, there was a comment by the person involved saying, you know what, my mum came in and tidied my house up the other day, and I was really offended by the fact that my mum came into my house and told me how to tidy it up and started doing it. And she said, well, okay, well, what needed tidying? And the conversation then moved to the desk, where apparently, I mean, you must know people like this, right, who have papers everywhere.
Yep.
And they'll tell you, but I know where everything is on this desk. Yeah, I have my own system. And as I was saying to my client is, but everybody else in that office has a really tidy desk, right? So actually what you're talking about here is a responsibility for your own conduct, behavior, demeanor, you name it. And you're entitled to ask someone to tidy their desk because they're part of a unit, but actually by not doing that, they're isolating themselves from the rest of the team. And also take responsibility for your personal hygiene as well, which is your responsibility.
I think most people know what to do. And if they don't, you can Google it. It's about how do you do it? How do you say it? How do you execute it effectively? And understanding how to manage those conversations is kind of the key, isn't it? I mean, I know you've explained there, it's different. There's different elements to it, isn't there? Like the reputationally, what do you do? Well, you know, when you've spoken to that person, how do you get that person to handle the fact that he knows that everybody's been talking about them smelling, or for example, in the situation?
Exactly.
It's managing at different levels, isn't it? And respectfully.
Well, this is the thing about the soft and hard skills. You've got your hard skills, which is the process. You know, I could discipline you if you continue to behave like this. And the softer skills is, how do I engage with you and stuff like that. But in that particular case, I felt for me, the key was empowering the manager, was helping the manager understand that you are responsible for managing this situation. And this is actually a great opportunity for you. Whenever you're dealing with disciplinary issues or any issues of any conduct issues, or in this case, body odor, you should also be using it as an opportunity to reinforce your role as a manager, which is about being supportive, right? So even if it's a conduct issue or a capability issue, surely you want the end result to be what the company needs it to be. So therefore, it would be an opportunity for you to say, look, you know, I'm as embarrassed as you are, but I'd much rather have this conversation face to face with you than not, and kick the can down the road and have you oblivious to the fact that there is a problem with the way you smell. So let's talk it through. What can we do to support you? Because what we want you to do is to have a successful career here. We want you to be part of the team. We want you to succeed. And you know, that's my role. So let's talk through why this has happened. What can we do in the future? And a really weird thing though, Tosh, though, is you turn around and said, well, yeah, but I wash every other day. That was the go-to, yeah? I wash every other day. Well, maybe you should wash every day then.
You know? Yeah. I mean, the way you said it just now, Stuart, it just rolled off your tongue very easily. It was delivered in a way that was received well. I think if I was that person, you still can't help feeling a little bit embarrassed, but it's not because of you, certainly, in terms of the way you said it. So, you know, that really kind of reinforces not just what you say, but the way that you say it. That you need to understand, if you don't know how to do that yourself, you need to speak to somebody like you about how to do that, right?
Yeah. But do you know what, as well, there were some subtleties which I find quite interesting. Like I say, the advice you can give is quite straightforward, right?
Yeah.
This is what I would say, but it was the subtleties around. So, for example, after that conversation, right, a few days later, she phoned up and said, I'm going to be late. I've woken up late. She came in late. And as everyone said, she clearly just threw on the clothes from yesterday.
Yeah.
Clearly did that, right? So they sent her home. Sent her home, and then over the next 2 days, they said she was a couple of minutes late. And you think, well, you know what? You are an employee. You are responsible for your own behavior, conduct, etc. If you're still coming into late 2 or 3 minutes later than what you should be doing, then you're actually not taking responsibility for your own part in this. Do you know what I mean? So
yeah,
you know, it was the subtleties around it, like the comment about the mother, the fact the desk was a little bit disorganized in line with the others, you know, very different desks. So actually, this was more of a conversation about taking personal responsibility, you know, is that we expect.
I think those are much easier, Stuart, right? That's to do with how you operate at work. When it comes to something that's a bit more personal, like your body odor, that's a tricky one. And I suppose, how did that turn out in the end? What did that person do, just out of interest? They take it on board?
They appear to take it on board, but I guess the point I was illustrating was that the bigger picture was her inability to organize herself.
Right.
Yeah,
right,
because it's still late. So she didn't really get the gist, yeah? And you must know people. I've known people that are always late. You know, they're not taking responsibility for their timekeeping. And in this case, she didn't take responsibility for what the company needed, which was her to get up early. She needed to shower, get changed, make herself presentable, do her hair, you know, and then present herself at work in good time to be able to start the work in time and be effective at the role. But obviously what I surmised and what they surmised as well was she wasn't taking responsibility for the necessity to get up on time, to take care of her appearance, her hygiene, and then come to work and not be under pressure because she was always coming in a few minutes late. So unfortunately, she failed a probationary period. So I don't think she took it on board.
Yeah, understood. But as I say, the key is the ability to have the structure of a conversation. And I suppose if I were to break it down into its elements, Stuart, the idea is focusing on the outcome that you want and also understanding it from the other person's perspective, because what comes out of our mouth and how it's received can be different things. So understanding that the best way that can be delivered really means looking at that person and saying, if I was in your shoes, you know, what do I need to hear, see, and feel for what we want them to do to land effectively? Is that not right? Is that the structure effectively?
Absolutely, yeah. That's where the soft skills become really, really important. Your ability to engage with people on a human level. In that particular case, it's quite embarrassing. That's one thing. But obviously, there are other conversations you have around sensitive issues like bereavement or, you know, over ill health and things like that. And having the ability to engage with people to make them feel like they're on your side or you're on their side. And the hard skills are all about imposing a process. But you need the match of the both. You know, you need to be able to have the soft skills to engage so people believe you're on their side. But you need to be able to have the ability to put in place a plan or a process to hold people accountable for doing their job. But that's why I always feel like with disciplinary situations or in this, it's actually an opportunity for you as a manager to shine.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Grasp it with both hands. And that person will be a willing member of staff that will run through brick walls for you if you can manage that relationship effectively.
Super helpful, Stuart. Anybody watching this who wants some advice on these sorts of managing these difficult situations or embarrassing situations, Stuart's contact details go out with this podcast, as do all of our experts that we have sitting on these podcasts with us. Stuart Faulkner, thank you very much. Everybody, right. Thank you very much for watching and see you again next time.
Back for a swim.
Go and enjoy yourself. See you, everybody. Bye-bye.